When working with the Octatrack, I often quite enjoy the lack of visual feedback, but one simple strategy I've found very useful is to use a continuously resampling buffer of the main outputs, simply to have easy access to a crude oscilloscope display. Since I'm generally using a master track in my projects, I often want to use track 8's recording buffer for this purpose. I'll start setting that up here. Usually I want about a bar or two of recording length. Really just depends on what kind of resolution of the display I want at the time. So I'll set this to 16 steps, and then it needs to record from the main. Now I need to go into grid record mode and get a record trig. With function and edit in the record setup menu, we can jump directly to the waveform display for the record buffer. However, it would be much easier to use the track and edit button shortcut to jump to the waveform display. If you set up your project from default like I did, and then put the master track on immediately, that's just going to take you to the static slot list. This is just recording half a bar, or 8 steps here. I want to see a slightly longer stretch of time, so I'm going to set that to 32 steps. I'll just skip ahead a little bit, take a look at that waveform. Okay, that looks fine. Let's try fixing the shortcut problem. The default machine that the Octatrack loads onto a track is the static machine. So in order to get the shortcut for track 8 to reference its recording buffer, I'm going to need to go into the project menu and deactivate the master track temporarily. The reason for the gain increase when turning off the master track was because track 8 had a level below 127. Now I'm going to turn track 8 into a flex machine, and I'm going to set it to its record buffer. To actually check that shortcut. And here's one of the number one reasons I like to use this technique, is to know whether I'm clipping on the way out of the Octatrack. Now to turn this back into a master track. Time to try that shortcut again. There we go. Easy access to a crude waveform display of the main output. Some Octatrack users might find this annoying, but I really like having the master track level control available as an alternative to using the main level. Take a look at the waveform. You can see it's clipping. So let's go back and forth on this level a bit and see how it interacts. Now it's time to put a compressor on the master track. Having the waveform display will make it a little easier to analyze what's going on. I think I want it as a peak compressor for now. The effect of a peak compressor will be more dramatic and easier to hear. I'll start off by dialing in the threshold and ratio. Already a good bit of gain reduction, so let's add some back. Lots and lots of gain available on this compressor. Setting up a slow attack with a very fast release can often result in a lot of pumping and distortion added to your signal. As I raise the gain here, you can see in the waveform display that we're beginning to clip the compressor internally. Okay, time to back off the gain. Let's try some different compression levels. I'll turn up the master slightly. Now I'm going to gently massage the threshold and ratio controls to affect the level of compression. We've definitely lost some overall signal levels. Let's take a look at the waveform. Lengthening the release time will reduce the pumping artifacts. With a fast attack and a long release, adding some gain can give you some big chunky blocks. I'll make that even more extreme with higher compression levels, and then I'll need to add back that gain. A lot of the times with the compressor, all you need is a very small amount of gain. Time to slow down the attack and let a bit more transients through. Okay, even slower attack now. Listen carefully as I sweep the attack down to a very fast speed, back to a very slow speed. As I shorten the release time, listen for when the pumping effect begins to occur. The pumping is caused by the compressor entering its release phase during the tail of a sound. The more makeup gain you're using, the more dramatic the pumping effect will become. See, we're getting some transient spikes here. This is one of the tricky parts of using these aggressive compressor sound shaping techniques. Unfortunately, the Octatrack compressor cannot function as a true limiter. That bass sound has been really brought up by this compression, so I'm going to turn the level on that down quite a bit. I also want to hear the compressor interact with the drums a bit more. Unfortunately, unlike the compressor on the machine drum, the Octatrack compressor does not have a high-pass filter on its input. So far, I've been running the compressor mix fully wet. Let's try some parallel compression. Parallel compression is simply mixing the uncompressed signal with the compressed signal. A common strategy is to heavily compress the compressed signal and add substantial amounts of gain to it before adding it back to the uncompressed signal. This greatly thickens and adds body to the sound by bringing up lower level elements, but a good amount of transient information is still retained by mixing in the dry signal. Let's listen to just the wet signal. Got a nice sausage going on there. Now to get a bit more extreme with this technique, I'm going to dial in a lot more gain reduction first. And now you'll discover why this compressor has so much gain. That's a pretty deep kick. With these extreme compression levels, I can probably just max out the gain without even internally clipping the compressor. A very fast release time in this type of extreme scenario makes for interesting distortion. Mixing in the dry signal reduces the pumping effect a bit, but changes it at the same time. With the gain all the way up, raising the threshold even just a little bit is going to get pretty crazy pretty fast. Now reduce that ratio. Time to get it back to some semblance of normal. Okay, I think I'm going to moderate the attack and release times a bit, because I want to try modulating this compressor. Adjust the threshold and ratio slightly, and I'll turn the mix all the way up. I only want the compressed signal. Now let's try modulating that compressor attack. Since the LFO is going to increase and decrease the attack from a central value, that's why I set the attack to about 70. This LFO depth of 28 is sweeping the attack value from 42 to 98. Now we'll put an LFO on the release as well. Don't want to sweep this one around as much. The attack and release are some of the more subtle parameters to modulate on the compressor, but for me they're usually the most interesting. All of the other parameters are related to gain in some way, whereas the envelope in the compressor is more about change over time. I'm thinking now that I want to set these LFOs to hold behavior so that I can get kind of a stepwise change in the transients. Time to massage the compressor a bit. Probably time to try something more extreme, really shape the sounds. Very interesting how the transients and the pumping is both kind of phasing in and out with each other. Time to revisit the LFOs. Okay, let's turn it up even more, I guess. You might have forgotten, but I've had this set as a peak compressor the entire time. Let's hear what effect the RMS value can have on what we're doing. Generally speaking, higher RMS values will result in a smoother compressor response. I liked it right here at 72. Okay, time to add another compressor to this master track with full RMS value. Our first compressor is more of a creative sound design compressor, so this compressor is going to be the true master compressor. I'll start off with a rather heavy-handed parallel compression approach. Make sure I'm not clipping on the way out. It's getting pretty close here. Probably clipping here. I guess not. Master track level is low enough. I'm going to adjust the modulation compressor a bit. Gotta turn down that bass sound a little. It just keeps gaining more and more presence. Now that there's a good amount of gain on this second compressor, you can really hear the action of the first compressor. Time to revisit the LFOs. There's a very interesting expansion and contraction of the transients caused by modulating the attack and release in this fashion. Okay, maybe time to start backing off the compressor a bit. Dynamics are starting to come back to it now. I'll mix in more of the compressed signal. I think this technique of having an experimental sound shaping compressor followed by a more standard compressor offers a lot of potential. Generally speaking, however, this approach is most effective on buses and not on individual instruments, unless they were live instruments with lots of dynamics in the signal.